чем кончилась вчера игра.
Конечно, я продулся страшно, мне не везет.
Вы до утра опять играли.
А ужасно мне надоело, черт возьми, вот разве видно.
Бил там Герман.
Бил, и как всегда с восьми до восьми утра прикован к горному столу. Дульбино.
И только
да на игру других смотрел.
Какой он странный человек.
Как будто у него на сердце злодеясь по крайней мере три.
Я слышал, что он очень беден.
Да, не богат. Вот он, смотри, Ему надо брачен лети.
Скажи мне, Герман, что с тобою?
Со мною ничего.
Ты болен?
Нет, я здоров.
Ты стал другой какой-то, чем-то недоволен. Ты мал, сдержан, перестись. Ты весел был, по крайней мере, теперь ты мрачен. Молчали, и я ушам своим не верю. Ты новой страстью горя, а говорят, до утра проводишь ночи за игрой.
Да, цели твердою ногой идти, как прежде, не могу я. Я сам не знаю, что со мной. Собой мне в силах больше, я влюблю.
Обнять.
Счастливый день! Читала, заикалась, затла. В числе приглашенных был граф Сен-Жермен. Следя за игрой, он слыхал, как она шептала в разгаре азарта. О, Боже! О, Боже! Карты. Выбрав удачно минуту, когда, покинув украдкой гостей полный зал, красавица молча сидела одна, влюбленно над ухом ее прошептал слова слаще звуков Моцарта.
Thank you. German is intensely in love with Lisa, but is now obsessed with the Countess's secret of how to win at cards. We've heard the first scene of Act One of Tchaikovsky's The Queen of Spades live from the Met in this new Metropolitan Opera production.
Thank you. призрак смерть.
чисто счастье.
We've heard Act One of this new production of The Queen of Spades by Tchaikovsky in this broadcast live from the stage of the Metropolitan Opera House in New York City. Despite herself, despite being engaged to the handsome, intelligent, and wealthy, and devoted Prince Yeletsky, Lisa finds herself in the arms of the frighteningly intense and gloomy German. Now the applause is welcoming Maestro Gergiev, back to the stand. Bravos ring out as he asks the orchestra to rise, bows to the house in acknowledgement of the cheers, and turns to finish. Broadcast live from the Metropolitan Opera House, that was the first scene of Act Two of The Queen of Spades by Tchaikovsky.
что ли? Нет. Огрешено! Я выведаю тайну старухи.
Thank you. бога, не пугайтесь. Я не стану вам вредить, я пришел вас умолять о милости одной. Вы можете составить счастье целой жизни, и оно вам ничего не будет стоить. Вы знаете три карты. Для кого вам беречь вашу тайну?
Ребятица, хотите ли мне назначить вы три карты? Тайны не устал.
тайны и узнал я.
Act two of The Queen of Spades by Tchaikovsky, German has frightened the Countess to death in a vain attempt to learn the secret of the three cards. Lisa is being sung by Maria Guleghina, Pauline by Birgitta Svendén, and the Countess by Leonie Rysanek. German is Gegan Grigorian, Count Tomsky is Nikolai Putilin, and Prince Yeletsky, Dmitry Hvorostovsky. Masha, Lisa's maid, was sung by Emily Pulley, Chloe was Marie Plett, the Master of Ceremonies, Anthony Dean Griffey, Czekalinski, Peter Kazaris, and Surin Julian Robbins in this production, broadcast live from the Metropolitan Opera House. And now a wave of bravos as Maestro Gergiev mounts the podium, shakes hands with Konstantin Stoyanov. He's smiling to the house, gesturing to the orchestra, and turning to conduct.
набережной, когда нас никто не может видеть там. Если до полуночи ты не придешь, я должна буду допустить страшную мысль, которую гоню от себя. Прости, прости. Я так страдаю.
Thank you. тройка, семерка. Туз, тройка, семерка. Туз.
Gammon has learned the secret of winning at cards. 3, 7, ace, troika, semyorka, twos.
Thank you. сердце и пробьют, что он убийца. Соблазните! Ах, страшно, страшно!
Thank you. они принадлежат.
Могу я, что ты говоришь? Опомнись.
Ах, я забыл, ведь ты еще не знаешь. Ты как бы помнил, что тогда еще я выведать хотел у старой ведьмы.
Могу я,
у меня она была, и мне сама три карты назвала.
Так значит, ты ее убил?
О нет, зачем? Я только поднял пистолет, и старая колдунья вдруг упала.
From the Met. That was Act 3, Scene 2 of The Queen of Spades by Tchaikovsky. Lisa, tortured over the German's obsession with gambling and his responsibility for the death of the Countess, has walked into a dark river.
Oh! попал, я прежде не видал тебя у игроков.
Да, здесь я в первый раз, ты знаешь, говорят несчастные в любви в игре счастливы.
Что хочешь ты сказать?
Но больше не жени, не спрашивай меня, мне слишком больно, друг. Я здесь, чтобы отомстить. Ведь счастье в любви бьет порой в игре несчастье.
Объясни, что это значит.
Thank you.
остаться буду в секунданте, ты не откажешься, молись на меня.
Садись ко мне, ты счастье приносишь.
Откуда ты, где ты?
Позвольте мне поставить карту.
Вот чудеса,
вот чудеса, вот чудеса, наш Герман, наш Герман.
Приятель, поздравляю с разрешением судового поста.
А сколько?
40 000.
Live from the Met, Tchaikovsky's The Queen of Spades. Germain's last card was not an ace, but the fatal Pique Vaya Dama. And the Countess has had her revenge. And today is the Countess's day, the beloved Leonie Rysanek, in her farewell broadcast from the Metropolitan Opera House after a glorious career here that began in 1959 with her spectacular debut triumph as Lady Macbeth. A leading critic then called her that operatic rarity, a true stage personality, and spoke of her traumatic power. Well, we've enjoyed that personality and power this season in these, her final performances on the operatic stage in America. The very last one, next Tuesday night. She makes her operatic farewell next August at Salzburg, another scene of her many triumphs, and she'll sing Clytemnestra, which she has also sung at the Met. Now the bow lights are on, and here come Dmitri Hvorostovsky, Aria Guleghina, Gergiev Grigorian, Leonie Rysanek, Nikolai Pukilin, Dmitri Hvorostovsky as Prince Yeletsky, Aria Guleghina as Lisa, Gergiev Grigorian, German, Birgit Svenden as the maid, and Nikolai Pukilin leaving now as Count Tomsky. Here are Anthony Dean Griffey, Murray Plett, Ludmila Filatova, Emily Pulley, Anthony Dean Griffey, the master of ceremonies at the ball, Murray Plett, Chloe in the pastoral play, Ludmila Filatova, the governess, and Emily Pulley, Masha, is Lisa's maid. And here are Tony Stevenson, Kurt Link, Peter Kazaris, and Julian Robbins. Tony Stevenson, Chaplitsky, Kurt Link, Narumov, Peter Kazaris, Chekalinsky, Julian Robbins, Surin, all in handsome military costume. And here's Nikolai Pukilin, who was Tomsky for the Kirov Opera when they appeared here at the Met in 1992. His many roles include Iago, Figaro, Scarpia, M. Escamillo, leaving Los Bravos. He's been on Jägen, Prince Igor, Rigoletto, Birgit Svenden, Magdalena, and Die Meistersinger 2 weeks ago, and the Erda in the Met telecast of The Ring. Frequently appears at Bayreuth. She's appeared at La Scala, Munich, San Francisco, Seattle. Dmitri Hvorostovsky, the distinguished recitalist, bowing to the Bravos. He has appeared recently at La Scala, Venice, Buenos Aires. This season for Chicago, he's Valentin and Faust. For Covent Garden, Germain and Cariata. For Vienna, extending his arms to all that applause, bowing deeply. For Vienna, he's Figaro and the Barber of Seville this season. Here's Maria Guleghina, who sang Lisa for her debut with San Francisco, extending her arms in response to the Bravos. For the Met, her debut role was Maddalena in Andrea Chenier in 1991. She was gesturing to the orchestra. And we've heard her as Tosca, blowing a kiss to the house now. Also, Santuzza in Cavalleria Rusticana. This season, she debuted at the Covent Garden and the Bastille Opera. And now, Leonie Rysanek, who has sung 24 different roles for the Metropolitan Opera, bowing in her glamorous rose-colored taffeta dress as the Countess, blowing a kiss to the house. A leading critic recently called her adventurous and admirable. She's been an outstanding empress in Die Frau ohne Schatten, Elisabeth Tannhäuser, Ziegler, and, as you heard, Senta in Flying Dutchman. And now Gergiev Grigorian, who was German for the Kirov Company at the Met in 1992, also receiving his share of the Bravos. He was also Prince Shuisky in Boris Godunov. He's extending his arms to the audience now. Among his other roles with the Kirov have been Lenski in Eugene Onegin and Pierre Bazukhov in War and Peace, Andre in Tchaikovsky's Mazeppa for the Opera Orchestra of New York, and now Valery Gergiev. And the Bravos increase as he gestures now, clenching his hands toward the orchestra. He conducted the Met's new production of Otello for his debut in 1994, although he had already conducted the Kirov here. Maestro Gergiev is both artistic director of the Kirov and principal conductor of the Rotterdam Philharmonic, This season, he conducts at San Francisco, London, La Scala, New York Philharmonic, Royal Philharmonic. Now he's brought on the rest of the cast: Dmitry Hvorostovsky, Maria Guleghina, Leonid Rysanek, Gergiev Grigorian, Birgitta Svendin, and Nikolai Putin. Ms. Rysanek has just left. Next week at 1:30 p.m. Eastern Time, Carlo Rizzi conducts Puccini's La Boheme with Barbara Fritoli, Patricia Rossett, Marcello Giordani, Dwayne Croft, Eduardo Del Campo, Stefano Palacci, and François Lou.
This production of The Queen of Spades is an historic event for one member of the cast, the mezzo-soprano Leonid Rysanek. After more than 35 years performing at the Met, she's decided that this is to be her farewell to the American stage. The production, new this year and produced by Elijah Moshinsky, opened at the end of October, and David Patrick Stearns, opera critic of USA Today, praised its dream cast. The critic of the New York Times, among others, was impressed by Rysanek's performance. "Miss Rysanek's stage presence is acting at its best," he wrote. "Grand opera vividness that retains a touch of subtlety." Well, tonight is her penultimate performance. She'll be singing The Countess for the last time on the stage at the Met on January the 2nd. Now back to Peter Allen once again to introduce the interval feature.
Leonid Rysanek has sung more than 20 roles at the Met since her 1959 debut as the company's first Lady Macbeth. Several weeks ago, Madame Rysanek talked with George Jelinek about her most recent and final role with the company.
The Met's new production of Tchaikovsky's The Queen of Spades, which will be heard only once this season after today, is an unqualified success. There is no question that Leonid Rysanek's unforgettable portrayal of the old countess has been a major contributor to that success. With this remarkable achievement, Madame Rysanek crowns her association with the Metropolitan Opera, which began in 1959. To begin what I hope will bring back great memories from those 36 years, let me ask you about today's opera. In all the past performances of the Queen of Spades, I have never seen the countess as such an active acting participant in the action. How much of that was direction and how much came from Leonid Rysanek's vast storehouse of stage experience?
Thank you. Well, let's see, at least half and half. He gave me good ideas, and I brought, of course, since this is my third new production of this Queen of Spades, the coming up from under the floor, you know, this very scary appearance in the third act at the place of Hermann was his idea. Of course, I build it a little bit up and say, then let me come as young. I think it's much more interesting have her come out as the young countess, as the Venus of Moscow, as she was called. Mm-hmm. So, and let me give him like the kiss of death, which I think is a good idea.
That was your idea?
This was my idea.
Wonderful.
Yes. And it worked. People said it's absolutely unbelievable how it... I can't see it, but everybody says it's very, very good, very well done.
It was extremely effective, and it brings to mind a frequent reference to yourself as a singing actress. Now, singing actress is very often referred to people who, shall we say, charitably act more than they sing.
Yes, that's why I don't like this word.
I don't like it either, but it never applied to you. Because I think for the right balance, I think you always regarded singing as topmost.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Acting must have come naturally to you.
I wanted to be an actress before I was a singer. I can't not forget that when I go on stage. But still, the first thing when I took on a new part, it's very important for me, is it for my voice? Is it good for my voice? Is it right for my voice? And so I have to look over the music. And then I look over the story. Is it good? Is it interesting? Is it boring? Like there's an opera I had to sing when I was very young, Agatha in Freischütz, which I loved to sing, but I hated to act because it's such a bore and so difficult to do.
Agatha is beautiful to sing, but there is no dimension
no,
in the character.
No, really not. There's one line, very right. Sweet, very blue-eyed and blonde hair.
Well, now, the other side of the coin is when there is too much intensity to be built into the role and you become an exciting person, you become a Tosca, you become a marshal in, you become Lady Macbeth, and you have all these dimensions. How to keep the balance?
This was always a big problem. All my career long, this was the fight. I knew when I went on stage, certain parts, like Tosk, like Lady Macbeth, Santa, Siglinde, all this, with brushless figures. Yes, high intensity. I always said to myself, or my husband says, please keep it down, don't overact. But I didn't overact on purpose. It comes out of me, you know. I knew it was sometimes too much. And the danger was, of course, if I did too much, I hurt my voice. So I screamed, maybe it's not the right word, but I oversang. I was a little bit sharp or flat or too much emotion, which is not so good. Real tears are killing the voice, of course, because it goes down your throat. And that's not the best for singing.
You know, I remember many years ago, I read in Shalyapin's autobiography, and he said that whenever the person is on stage, there are actually two people, one who does the acting and the other who observes the person who's acting.
I heard this from Birgit Nilsson once in an interview, or someone quoted her. She said, when Birgit Nilsson goes on stage, there's always Birgit Nilsson next to Birgit Nilsson, watch her, which I never do. There's one thing I have learned now really thoroughly and understood. When I go on stage, in the first 2 minutes, I absolutely am in the part. I am the 90-year-old countess. This is not Katharina the Great. I have to bow. And I am this old, wacky, and very fragile woman. But I also must admit, when the curtain comes down, strangely enough, immediately, it's like I turn off a light when I take my bow. It's Leonie Rysanek who takes the bow. It's not the countess. I'm happy. This was always the best reward for me. The biggest check is not as wonderful as the love and the admiration of the audience. That I will miss the most, I'm sure.
Well, that brings me to my next question, because your career began in Austria. It had many very important early landmarks, such as your first appearance in Bayreuth, which was 1951, then Munich, and all this time you were singing in Vienna, and you came to the Met in 1959. Where do you place your Met association in the overall picture?
Number one. Uh-huh. This house was my house. It still is my house and will always be as long as I'm alive. And I will come back and sit down outside in the audience, among the audience and the viewers, and I will enjoy it like I enjoy it now. When I don't want to think on the 2nd of January, because it's the farewell, which is hard for me, because I love this house, I love this city, and I love the people here. This is not a stupid compliment. Please believe me. This is because I had a fight with the Vienna people. They were really offended because I said that. I said, but that's the truth. I always said the truth. This is my house. But you are Viennese. It has nothing to do with Vienna. I love Vienna. But New York is my house, the number one. I'll miss the most this house.
I have a list here. It says you have sung 24 roles in almost 300 performances. Which of all these roles was closest to you at the Met?
I must say it was, of course, Santa.
Thank you.
as far as the Flying Dutchman is concerned, Senta, it had a very nondescript history at the Metropolitan before you and George London took over those roles. It was not a favorite Wagner opera at all.
Strangely enough, yes.
And ever since that performance, that very memorable
I remember, you know, when George told me we will do this in 60 at the Met, and we did it in 59 at Bayreuth, and it was a tremendous success there. So, but he said to me, but you know, this was never a success there. So I said, we will make a success. I think, you know, in former days, the cast, especially the center with the wrong sopranos, of course you have to have a voice, right, size enough for the for center, but it also has to have this girlish sound,
yes,
still. And this
Elsa youth sound.
Yes. Now you have better and younger singer, and right, it's always a big success if you cast it right.
Yes.
But this was a special singer I never forget.
It really
never,
was.
Never ever forget. Yeah.
It really was. So was your Sieglinde, and although I have a feeling that perhaps you would regard yourself more of a Richard Strauss interpreter than a Wagner interpreter, because you never did the heavy, heavy, murderous Wagner roles.
Now, finally, someone recognized that. Of course, I'm not a Wagner soprano. I never sang the Brünnhildes, with one exception. The first year, I sang Walküre Brünnhilde in Innsbruck, but never, ever again. So I was the Jugendliche, but I was never... Brünnhilde, never Isolde. And you are Wagnerian soprano if you sing Brünnhilde and Isolde. The most heaviest part I sang was Kundry.
Let us talk to Strauss for a moment, because that's where you really shone. And I think that he more or less invented those very high soprano part for your kind of voice.
So his son said after my first Salome in Munich, he said, my father must have dreamed of soprano like you are.
Let me talk about Salome and Elektra. Is Elektra the toughest of all?
Well, I can't tell, because, first of all, Böhm was already very, very ill when we did it. I was like this when we did the studio, the tape for the movie.
Yes.
So then Fischer Dieskau, who sang Orestes, did not show up. So I had to sing without Orestes. Mm. Unfortunately, I knew the opera very well, so I learned it very well. But still, it's difficult to sing it without a partner, you know. The emotion is not the same.
Among the roles that you sang in Europe, but not at the Met, a remarkable exception is Turandot. And I suppose the size of the Met had something to do with
no,
it.
No.
No?
Nothing at all.
Really?
No. I sang it the last time. I sang it in 57, I think it was 57, in Los Angeles with the San Francisco Opera. And I got a standing ovation after the riddle scene. Hmm. I never forget that. And then the famous critic, I think he's still alive, he's a very, very old man, Goldberg?
Yes, Albert Goldberg.
I think he's still alive.
Yes.
In those days, I didn't read, understood English, very little, school English, very, very few words. And someone read to me the review, raving.
Mm.
And then came the word, but. The word but is always
you
bad.
You hate buts.
But, so he, at the very end, he wrote, I'll never ever want to hear this wonderful, beautiful voice again in this horrible part.
Oh.
So I really took it serious in those days, critics, you know.
Yes.
So I never touched it.
Yes.
And I must admit, Pink often asked me to do it, but I was always Birgit, you know. And
yes.
And I always said to myself, well, I'm different. I would do it different, of course. But still, she is soaring over there.
Yes.
And my voice is a darker, softer voice, so I'm not sure it would be the same effect here in the house. And I was coward.
Well, as I mentioned before, and in this respect, it was something quite unusual that you excelled in so many Italian roles, and we could never tell anyone that Leonie Rysanek is a German soprano, because then we would have to ignore the Toscas and the Macbeths and the Ballos.
Yes.
And you even did Nabucco, which the Met only staged once.
Yes. If you don't have a great Abigail.
Yes.
You cannot do it. It's a very difficult opera.
It's another
murderous part. It's a very, very, very difficult.
Yes.
And a lot of singers keep away from this part because it's a dangerous part.
Tell us as you remember these wonderful productions, and you have excelled in many new productions at the Met, Frau Schatten, Macbeth, Nabucco, Ariadne, any colleagues that come to your mind that you were particularly close artistically and possibly as friends?
You know, to be friend with another singer, let's be very honest here, is very difficult. This is a hard, very hard profession. And everybody, even the tenor or the bass, is your competition on stage in the evening. So friends, I think I was only, I think, Birgit. She was a friend. And she is a friend, I hope. Friend. I admired a lot of them. And I respect very many of them. But friendship, with friendship I understand different things, you know?
Yes.
Which are difficult if you sing the same roles or similar roles.
It's understandable.
Or you take your solo bow, you know? All those things count.
Yes. No? There is a competitive atmosphere.
Absolutely.
That intrudes.
Especially in a house like the Met.
Yes. Why is the Met,
I don't
especially?
Know. It's a big famous house.
Right.
It's like La Scala or Vienna. It's one, four or five great houses in the world, I think. And competition is very hard. I know, I remember Tosca with Corelli, and you know how he was beloved here. I thought,
yes.
My God, what an evening will that be? And it was a great evening. He was nice, and he behaved nice, and he was not so hysterical, nervous there. On this evening, I remember that. He was very sweet. But there were Aidas, he wasn't so sweet. Don't touch me, don't come near me.
And then, how do you look at retirement?
Well, with one eye laughing and the other with a tear. But
just like the Marshalin.
Of course, it's if you do have something to not lose, to give up.
Yes.
It's always difficult. Youth, beauty, fame, love, or even well, it's more than my life. It's my whole life is. I devoted it to my career, and of course it's. I'm talking like it's nothing. I'll do this and this and this and this. There will be days in which I will suffer, I'm sure, but I will not be bitter, which I think is the most stupid thing one can do. I have so many interests, you know. I live in Vienna, which is cultural, a great city, so I can go to the opera in concert, which I love to do. In theater's my big love. Even cabarets, there are thousand things I'd like to read. I go to museums. And I don't have to go up in the morning, 5 o'clock. Oh, my God, I can't sing. That's another beautiful lookout.
You know? The pressure will be gone.
Yes, absolutely. I'm not afraid, and I will come and visit.
At
least
hope so.
New Yorker will visit.
And all New Yorkers, all opera-going New Yorkers will expect you to
but I'm
come
still
back
here.
And not to be a stranger to us, where you always will be welcome and where we remember you with so much affection.
In an interview recorded last month, we've heard George Jelinek talking with Leonie Rysanek, who is singing the role of the Countess in today's broadcast.